Hi, in this video series, we will finally talk about swales. This is one of the most popular permaculture water features that brings a lot of controversy inside and outside permaculture communities. So, are swales good or bad? You tell me after watching this video. So today, we will go through the swale definition. We will learn how swales are constructed. We will talk about swale sizes, distance, swale vegetation, as well as swale security components. And we will also tell you how we constructed our swales on our site according to our climate and soil conditions. So let's dive in. Let's define what is a swale. In permaculture, the word swale means something different than most people think. In regular landscaping, it usually means grassy ditch for draining water. So the ditch conveys water to a different location, for example, pond. But in permaculture, swale is a level excavation that helps water soak into the ground. And outside of permaculture, this is called bund or a bank. I have taken this explanation from the Permaculture Earthworks Handbook by Douglas Barnes. Bill Mollison, in his Permaculture Designer's Manual Handbook, states that swales are intended to store water in underlying soils or sediments. So they are cross-flow dry channels or basins intended to totally intercept overland flow, to hold it for a few hours or few days, and to let it infiltrate as groundwater recharges into the soil and tree root systems. So permaculture swales without trees planted on the swale mounds are not really swales. They would be uncompacted ditches posing a risk of waterlogging. So if you would like to dive deep into this subject, I created a video that hopefully will help you understand the roles of trees in the ecosystem. Because without trees, there wouldn't be evapotranspiration, which is basically the total amount of water that goes from the ground and plants into the air as vapor, which is so crucial to enhance arid and semi-arid climates, because evapotranspiration is like the first step in cycle that eventually leads to the formation of rain clouds and precipitation. So how would we construct swales? Firstly, we would measure level on ground. In permaculture, the most popular and cost-effective method for measuring ground level is an A-frame. It consists of three pieces of wood or metal arranged in the shape of an A. And we have string or straight edge is hung from the apex, and when the two legs of the A are positioned on level ground, the string indicates levelness. So before excavating a swale, you need to have level determined on your ground, and it is typically marked with flags. We marked it with bamboo sticks because that's what we had at the time. And one thing you should remember is to mow the grass before checking the level. Otherwise, it will be uneven. If you're familiar with building ponds, the way you do it with swales is different because you don't compact the swale bottom or berms. Remember, the aim is not to convey water to other place, but to hold water. Because the swale bottom and berm is uncompacted, the water that we catch will be slowly infiltrated to the soil. Depending on the site conditions, you could do certain things with swales to further assist water infiltration. For example, if you have heavy soils, you deep rip the swale bottom to help loosen the soil. In arid conditions, on the other hand, in sandy soils, you can gravel the swale bottom to prolong the time in which water remains in swale, so it's available for tree roots for longer. So in permaculture, we apply certain tricks according to the climate, soil conditions, and the amount of rainfall. So you can put manures to inside the swale, and this natural fertilizer would be diluted across the length of the swale, soaking into the ground, helping your trees planted on swale berm to grow better. And also helping the vegetation behind the swale. So for example, you could have hardier species that are more drought tolerant than those you plant on swales. Is there a spot where installing swales wouldn't be recommended? Absolutely. So we wouldn't install swales on slopes steeper than 18 degrees. You may also be careful about putting swales where the water table is high. But if you'd like to develop aquaculture paradise, I'm talking about sweetwater crustaceans and aquatic edible plants, you can create swales in such places and they would naturally convert to wet chinampa channels, which is a topic for another video. Other than that, you could have swales in every climate. It doesn't matter if it's humid or arid, or if the soil is sandy or not. We can over time increase the water infiltration rates of sandy soil by improving its structure. And one thing that may not be clear to many people is that you don't clear forest to create swales. This is because existing trees, doesn't matter if they are invasive or not, they inherently serve as water harvesting components. So felling trees to accommodate swales is both inefficient and wasteful. If you have abundance of rainfall throughout the entire year and it's cold, so you have no evaporation, swales are not necessary for you because you don't need to capture extra water. In humid tropics, it depends. You may want to work on water infiltration rates in soil first by conditioning the soil, which is also a topic for another video. But sometimes swales in very humid tropical climate, if designed and positioned correctly, can help you grow trees very effectively. When it comes to swale sizes, unfortunately, there is no one answer. Again, it all depends where you are. Generally speaking, in sandy soils, you want to make swales wider and shallower. In heavy clays, you want them narrower and deeper. If you want to install swales on your property, I strongly recommend you to either hire a permaculture designer and consultant like me, or at least consult with a permaculture designer, because you don't want to be in a position of many people that just heard of swales and decided to do an experiment and they've learned they don't work, or worse, they cause damage to the property. You see, a good, experienced permaculture designer looks at your annual average precipitation rates and also highest 24-hour rainfall events and size swales and other water features according to this data, the climate, and according to the type of soil. So I can't give you one answer that would fit all sides. However, I can give you an example of how we sized our swales on our land, but please don't copy this model blindly. So you need to know that we live in central Italy. We have humid subtropical climate. We have dry summers and wet winters. Although we could argue whether winters are really wet because we also have dry spells in winter time. The average annual precipitation is about 500 millimeters. And we have clay soil on our land. And the slope where we positioned our swales is between 13 and 15 degrees, which is within the permitted 18 degree slope range. Remember, if your slope is steeper than that, terraces, benches, and net and pan system is more appropriate to plant your trees. Because rainfall is not equally distributed throughout the year, when it finally rains in autumn, winter or spring, we have to catch as much water as we possibly can. But what it really means? So look at our property. We have quite a bit of a field here. So it would be a waste of an opportunity if we dug like really small swales. And the hill behind the last swale, it was crying for water. So because we have a high clay content in soil and because we're on slope, it wouldn't make much sense to create like really wide swales. Although one would consider a 1 meter wide swale quite wide. But traditionally, like in arid flat landscape, your swales can be and actually should be quite wide. I'm talking 3, 4, 5 meters wide, so over 6 feet. And that's okay there, because you want to catch as much of the rainfall as possible in really wide and shallow swales, because the rainfall occurs just once a year, or maybe even less frequently. So we have to catch as much rain, as much water as we possibly can during the raining season. So the depth of the swale is from 40 centimeters to half a meter depth, and we found this depth to be perfect during unusual rain events last year, which occurred in April, May and June. So the rule of thumb is that the width must be 3 times bigger than the depth to create an appropriate angle back cut for stability. And the swales were full almost every day, partly because we directed excess water from the pond above. If we didn't have pond, the swales wouldn't be too full. But they were, and it was such a blessing. So guys, before the swales were installed on this land, we were getting excess water gathered on the road just above over there behind those trees. There is a road, and under the road there is a culvert, and it just distributed heavy flow of rainwater onto this hill, and it caused a lot of erosion, not only on this side of the hill, but also below where the swales currently are, and then also down in the forest. So it's a blessing to be able to convey the water now via this 12 centimeter pipe to our pond, and from our pond to swales. So basically the rainwater flow is pacified within the swales. It soaks really slowly to the underground, and then with the gravity force it is pulled to groundwater reserves, and the excess goes to the valley in a really really steady flow. And this process is explained in my rainwater management webinar, which you can find here or down in the description below. So imagine if we sized the swales differently. Imagine if we created just 10 centimeters deep swales. It's really unlikely we would be able to catch so much water as we did last year. And because of the high precipitation amounts, the small berms of swales would be likely destroyed. So we wouldn't be able to direct excess water from the pond to those swales. So it would be a really, really like waste of an opportunity. Now, last spring's rains were quite unusual. And the year before that, the swales were barely filled. Did it make me question the sizing of swales? Not even for a bit. Because in my permaculture designer's course run by Jeff Lawton, I was prepared for different scenarios, and I knew that I have to apply arid climate strategies. You see, it's okay if the swales are empty for the majority of the year. It really doesn't hurt the landscape. In fact, in this case, it's better we dug swales that deep because we had so much material to create nice fluffy mounds. Remember, we don't compact the swale berms, so in comparison to heavy compacted soil on the field, when you put your tree in a fluffy mound of soil, it's easier for it to thrive. We just made a mistake in terms of time of planting the fruit trees, and I explained it in this video. In terms of the swale distance, it really depends again. In steeper country, it's okay if swales are closer to each other. are like every 3 to 7 meters. In flat landscape, there can be bigger distances because you can capture more water than on the hill. It also depends on your goals, what you would want to grow and what annuals you want to keep. I hope this sizing example was useful to you, but as I need to stress again, please, please don't copy someone else's or my solutions. Please consult, and sometimes one consultation could save you so much work and hassle in the future, trust me. So there is one more often forgotten aspect of the swale creation, and this is vegetation. When you dig mini swale or hire an excavator operator, you need to be ready to sow cover crops on swale berm, and it has to be done immediately after the swale mound is dressed. And what is swale dressing? Before the earth is moved and the mound is created, you need to firstly strip the topsoil and put it on the side. When the mounds of subsoil are ready, you put the topsoil on the mound. If you have an excavator operator, they will do it for you. So the topsoil is nicely combed along the berm over the subsoil. And as soon as this is done, you walk behind the machine, sow the cover crop seeds 5 times more densely than prescribed on the packaging, cover with topsoil and water. And this will ensure you have a great growth of vegetation that will keep the swale berm stable. Then you wait for rain, and then you can plant your pioneer trees. So your hardy nitrogen-fixing legume trees, for example, either in spaces designated between fruit trees or on the other side of the berm. And you wait 1 year for them to establish fertility, break the compacted soil, or increase water infiltration rates in sandy soils. And then you plant your highly valued productive trees, which will grow so much better next to the hardy pioneers than without them, trust me. There is also another safety component to swales, and these are level sill spillways. So these are emergency spillways for the highest historic 24-hour rain events to allow safe discharge of excess water from the swales without causing erosion on your land. And this is a non-negotiable swale component. It's sized according to the highest historic 24-hour rain occurrence, and it could be placed on swale ends. And it's level area, regularly mowed or paved with concrete or covered in stones, allowing excess water to exit as a thin sheet of water. And spillways are placed in addition to swivel pipes conveying water from one swale to another, for example. Well, I hope you have found this information useful. I would like to announce that I am working on a side project, hopefully involving you. I am creating a space for private permaculture community where we all learn from each other with live streams, webinars, or even feedback videos about your projects. So it will be announced really soon, and I hope you will join me on this adventure. In the next video, I'll go through some swale myths and tell you what I think of them. Thank you so much for watching.